Welcome on this presentation on approach, Langdon procedure, and training recommendations. Approach and landing may raise a lot of questions. What are the answers to these questions? Glide, flare out, hold off, and the last one. And the last one is clearly not acceptable. During this presentation, we'll focus on two areas, the stabilization of the aircraft and the landing. The targets are be stabilized at the latest stabilization gate and of course remain stabilized down to the landing, particularly in adverse weather conditions. Two parts in the presentation, the criteria for approach stabilization and the crosswind landing. First, the approach stabilization. Due to a lot of ATC constraints now, we have seen that most of the time a speed of 160 knots is required up to 4 miles to the threshold. This is applicable in London, Dubai, and a lot of major airports. Therefore, you may have seen some changes in our flight crew operating manual. In June 2016, we added a note that the later stabilization, speed stabilization, is acceptable in case of ATC request. And in December 2017, we have opened this later stabilization for non-constrained approaches. So as per FCOM, the stabilization criteria height is 500 feet in visual meteorological conditions and 1000 feet in instrument meteorological conditions. Of course, this in accordance with policy and regulation of your airlines. To have this later stabilization, you have to be on the lateral and vertical part of the approach, in landing configuration, no excessive parameter deviation, stable in thrust, and of course the target speed at the VPP or ground speed mini. Remember that we have a call out when the speed exceeds the VPP plus 10. The evolution was of course on the thrust and the target speed. And the main parameter as well is that you have to maintain the stabilization down to the landing. When we analyzed these requirements of 160 knots up to 4 miles final, tests have been done with different aircraft. And we have seen sometimes that it's difficult to cope with this profile, especially at low weights. We will have the same issue on aircraft with a good lift to drag ratio. This has led to requests from operators to have a later speed and thrust stabilization IMC to avoid unnecessary go-rounds. In the regulation and guidelines, we couldn't find anything in the EASA or FAA. There is no precise regulation, but some documents from the ALR toolkit and the briefing notes have given this that the 1000 feet in IMC and the 500 feet in VMC. As well, there is sometimes a note about the speed that should not be more than VRF plus 20. So for aircraft, the VRF is equal to the VLS for approach. VRF plus 20 gives an approach speed of VPP plus 15, which is just 5 knots above the criteria to call the speed differences. On the other hand, we have contacted the Civil Air Navigation Services. And they said as well that the speed of 160 knots is too fast for most of the aircraft to land at, and that to reduce the speed in the next coming miles, so from 1,000 feet to from 1,300 feet to 1,000 feet, could be difficult. Mid-2016, we have reviewed our position, so no impact of the statement on ATC policy. We had an increasing number with those constraints and of course new feedback from operators. So we allowed in June 2016 to have a later stabilization in IMC conditions. Of course there was an ATC speed constraint, so we allowed the delay in speed and thrust stabilization. Two conditions have to be met therefore. The aircraft must be in a deceleration towards the approach speed and the speed and thrust stabilization must not be later than 500 feet. This has been written in our flight crew operating manual for all our aircraft. And 2015, We have reviewed our position and we allowed as well a later stabilization even if there was no ATC constraint. So it's the operator responsibility to allow this in agreement with local authorities for the regulations and as well in accordance with your airline policy manual, which is normally approved by the national authorities. And this opening of the later stabilization has been introduced in the FCOM and 2017. So for all aircraft now in IMC, speed and thrust stabilization can be delayed to a lower altitude, provided that it's in accordance with regulation for approach, the airline policy manual, and the aircraft must be in a deceleration towards the approach speed. And speed and thrust stabilization must be achieved not later than 500 feet. The next chapter that we will see are the crosswind landings. So, as we have seen, we have the approach stabilization and you have to maintain the stabilization down to the landing continuously. The most common reason for destabilization below 1000 feet were seen with dynamic weather effects, high crosswind, rain, gusty conditions, and so on. Out of 9 runway excursions encountered in 2017, 8 of them had the same signature. It was in bad weather, most of the time in night condition, with reduced visibility and poor runway lighting. The aircraft was basically aligned over the threshold. Roll orders were sometimes in contradiction with the encountered condition. So with right crosswind, we have seen pilots in giving left roll orders. As well, sometimes pilots were trying to use the rudder pedals in order to retrieve the runway center lines. This is not the correct technique because this will generate a sidestep in the aircraft. Therefore, there is a need in order to review together the crosswind landings. First of all, be prepared for the crosswind landing. Always ensure that the pilot seat and rudder pedals are in a position that you allow full and immediate control movement to be exercised over all flight controls and the brakes. So the feet should be in position so that full rudder deflection combined with full braking, even differential, can be applied without any delay. So steer with your heels and brake with your toes. The recommended techniques for landings is either the crabbed approach or sidestep approach. The recommended technique of Airbus is the crab technique. During the approach, fly wings level during the whole approach. Keep the crab angle until the end. Let's see how you can train pilots for the crosswind landings. You can do this by doing it with the autopilot and explain the autopilot logic. When the approach is flown by the autopilot will fly a crabbed approach. Around 50 feet he will start the flare, around 30 feet he will decrab, and then this will end with the rollout and the touchdown. So the phases are flare, decrab, and touchdown. Next, we could ask where is the localizer antenna located in the aircraft? Is it the nose? Is it at the middle of the aircraft or at the aft? Well, on all Airbus aircraft, the localizer antenna is located in the radome in the center of the aircraft. When we decrab an aircraft, where will the aircraft turn? Is it close to the cockpit? Is it around the main landing gear? Or is it at the back of the aircraft? Studies have shown that during the decrab, there is a combination of forces on the aircraft when we apply rudder. And basically the aircraft will turn around the point between the cockpit and the center of gravity. And the aircraft will move towards the wind. The decrab technique is use the rudder to align the aircraft with the runway centerline during the flare. Use appropriate role input when the site seeks to contact the drift down. The aircraft will rotate on a vertical axis forward of the CG close to the cockpit, and a partial decrap is acceptable during the landing. Avoid drifting downwind. Use roll control as long as you are in the air to keep the aircraft on the center line. The roll control makes the aircraft turning. Bank angle should not exceed 5 degrees. During the landing phase, a partial decrap is acceptable but should not exceed 5 degrees. What happens with the landing gear? So first aim for a positive touchdown. When the main landing gear touches down, a pivoting moment is created around the vertical axis located at the level of the main landing gear. This is due to the combined effect of the lateral friction of the tires on the surface and by the inertia forces applied at the center of gravity. This pivoting moment tends to turn the aircraft longitudinally towards the motion vector, thus the center line. During crosswind landing, the cornering force of the turning wheels is the primary means to maintain the aircraft on the runway centerline. A low rotor brake setting increases the cornering forces of the wheel. Be prepared to use large and immediate inputs on the rudder pedals to maintain the centerline, and if needed, use differential braking to keep the aircraft on the centerline. The effect of the reverses. When you use the reverses, we have two components when the aircraft is not aligned. We have one force parallel to the runway and one which is perpendicular to the runway, which increase the crosswind effect. If a directional problem occurs during the landing roll with the use of the reverse, consider reducing the reverse thrust. If braking manually, consider reducing braking temporarily or use differential braking. When the directional control has been regained, manual braking can be reapplied and reverse thrust can be reapplied as well. On this plot, we see different traces. The most important one is the yellow one, the nose landing gear, where the localizer antenna is located. So we see that this point is always, of most of the time, close to the center line of the aircraft. So the aircraft will approach in crab, and during the decrab and the rollout, the aircraft will align and stay in the middle of the runway. So it's quite important, as conclusion, to review the knowledge for crosswind landings, the aerodynamics effects during the decrab, function of the rudder and function of the ailerons. The rudder are to align with the runway centerline. The ailerons is to avoid drifting downwinds. You have as well dynamics in directional control, which is the effects of the cornering forces of the landing gear and the tires, and the effects of the reverses. How to train for crosswind landing? The instructor should demonstrate the flare and the decrap with the autopilot. The instructor could demonstrate the same in manual flight, and then the trainee perform crosswind landings. Thank you for reviewing this presentation.